Hello students, welcome back to the channel. Today we are going to take up an interesting topic, that is the Union Parliament, from the subject civics. I know sometimes understanding civics becomes complicated and students find it boring too, but trust me, if the basics are clear and it is studied in a proper manner, it is considered to be one of the most interesting subjects, as well as it helps you understand the political system of the country. And since you all are the youth, it's very essential for you all to understand how the democracy works and how the political system works so that you could contribute for the welfare of the society in future. So what is a union parliament? Union denotes center, and parliament is a setup or an institute wherein the leaders who are elected by the people by exercising their vote, they make laws on different subjects, which further makes all of the citizens live peacefully. All these laws are written down in a constitution which each and every citizen has to follow. So in short, the major role of the parliament is to make laws. Under this, the subtopics are India's democratic setup, that is understanding the federal and non-federal features, the union parliament, its composition, its features, what are the qualifications or disqualifications of the members, the various powers and the duties that the parliament has, detailed understanding of how the parliament works, that are the two houses, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, understanding various parliamentary procedures which includes 0 hours, quorum, question hours, etc., and speaker, like who is a speaker, what are its roles and responsibilities, how is he or she elected, and what are its functions. Now let us look at the democratic setup of India. Now what is a democracy? We all know democracy is a system wherein people have the right to choose their own leaders, that is to choose their own government who can rule them and work for their welfare. Now different countries have different democratic setup depending upon the features, that is whether they have adopted the federal form or they have adopted unitary form. India is a very unique kind of a democratic setup wherein it has both federal features as well as unitary features, which is also called as non-federal features. Now let us look what federal features are. Federal includes division of powers between the center and the state. That is, there is no single government that rules the whole nation. Instead, the powers are divided among different governments, that is in the form of state governments. It is the reason in India different states have their own respective governments which work in coordination with the central government. Also, the federal feature consists of bicameral legislature. Bicameral legislature is wherein the houses, the union parliament, is subdivided into two houses, that is Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, that we are going to discuss in detail in the further part of the topic. The houses represents both people elected for the center as well as people elected from the various states. So this helps understand that at the central level also the participation of states is equally encouraged in the form of a bicameral legislature. And the next is distribution of financial resources. The money or the revenue which is required by the state government is also distributed to them in the form of taxes, some from the center and some which they directly collect from the people living in their own state. This clearly shows that the center and state together work for the welfare of the country, and this refers to the federal feature. Now let us look at the unitary features. Unitary setup is wherein there is only and only one government that rules the whole territory or the nation, so makes important laws on the subjects which are mentioned in the union list, such as foreign relations or currencies, etc. And in India, despite of having different government, that is state and central, but the constitution is only and only one, that is everybody has to follow the same constitution. That is an important feature of unitary setup. Also, we have single citizenship. So for example, if you belong to two different states, that is Kerala or Maharashtra, but both of the people living will have the same citizenship, that is Indian citizenship. So irrespective of the state, everyone belongs to one nation. Next is emergency provisions. Also, there are different situations such as financial emergency or national emergency or failure of state machinery which requires attention of the center, and that is the reason at this point of time center takes the control of that particular state or the country depending upon which kind of emergency has occurred. And this shows that a strong center can control the whole territory at the time of need and can overpower the state governments. And next is existence of union territories. Union territories are exercised under the control of the president, or you can say the central government. So this again shows that the power of the centers are not only restricted at the central level, but they can also exercise it through the union territories, making them at par with the state governments. So through all these features, we can understand that India has a very, very strong center expressing unitary setup. But at the same time, it believes in division of powers for the growth of all the state, which shows federal setup. So therefore, it's a mix of both of them, and we generally use the word quasi-federal setup. Now moving ahead with the houses of the parliament. As I mentioned that the parliament is further divided into two, that is two houses, that is Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Both of them perform functions of lawmaking, and they together are called as the Union Parliament. Now let us understand about them in detail. Popularly, the either of the house is called as lower house or the House of People in case of Lok Sabha, and Rajya Sabha is also called as upper house or the Council of States. Elections: the members of the Lok Sabha are elected through general elections, which are conducted once in 5 years, and which also gives us the Prime Minister of the country, later formation of Lok Sabha. And in case of Rajya Sabha, the members are elected indirectly, that is, they are elected through proportional representation by single transferable vote, which means the members are elected from the different states' legislative assemblies on the basis of the proportion of their population. That is, the state which has larger population will have more members in Rajya Sabha as compared to the states which have a lesser population. Next, the term of the members of Lok Sabha is 5 years. That is, after every 5 years, new members are elected to the Lok Sabha. In case of Rajya Sabha, 1/3 of the total members retire after every 2 years. So generally, the membership of a member of Rajya Sabha is approximately of 6 years. Next is dissolution, which means end to the membership or the tenure of the particular house. In case of Lok Sabha, after the expiry of the term, that is after 5 years, or on the advice of the Prime Minister, the house can be dissolved even before a period of 5 years by the President. And in case of Rajya Sabha, it never gets dissolved, that it's a permanent house. Only the members keep retiring after every 2 years. And next is composition. Lok Sabha is comparatively a larger house than that of Rajya Sabha. Therefore, the members under Lok Sabha are total 552, among which 530 are elected from the states, 20 from the union territories, and 2 are the Anglo-Indians, which are nominated by the president to represent the Anglo-Indian community in India fairly. And in case of Rajya Sabha, there are total of 250 members, out of which 238 are elected and remaining 12 are nominated by the president from different areas of specialization, like in case of literature, science, etc. Now let us see who can be a member of Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha and what are the qualifications. Now the common qualification is that the person willing to be a member of the house should be an Indian citizen. That is, a citizen from any other country cannot become or is not qualified to be a member of the parliament. In case of Lok Sabha, the minimum age is 25 years, and in case of Rajya Sabha, the minimum age is 30 years. The person should have his name registered in electoral roll in some part of the country. That is, electoral roll is a list which is prepared for all the eligible voters of the country, and therefore the person should have his name registered in such list. Next, he should not be an insolvent, unsound mind, or a criminal. That is a person to be selected as a member of either of the house or the parliament should not be insolvent, means he should not be under a debt. He must have a capacity to carry out the basic financial activities in life. He should not be of unsound mind, that is his mind should be stable, he should be prudent so that he can make decision between what is good and what is bad for the country. He must not have any kind of a criminal record, that is a person who is a criminal or who has a criminal background will always have some kind of malicious intention or can cause harm to the society, and such member cannot be good enough for handling the parliament or the house of the nation. And he should not hold any office of profit under the government. The major objective of forming a government is social welfare, that is working for the welfare of the society. Therefore, any of the member is promoted to the house who has any interest, personal interest of or having any office of profit may definitely contradict with the welfare objective and thus harm the growth of the nation. So I hope we are clear with the qualifications of member, and let us move forward. Vacation of seats. Vacation of seats basically denotes the situation in which a particular seat or a position of a member in a house becomes vacant. There are different ways. One is resignation. When the member himself writes his resignation to the speaker or expresses his willingness to leave his position, it amounts to resignation. And the very moment the speaker accepts his resignation, the seat becomes vacant. Next is voluntarily absent for more than 60 days from all meetings. It is very essential for every member to participate in the discussions in the process of the parliament. And if he voluntarily remains absent for more than 60 days in the meetings without having any just cause, then his seat becomes vacant. For calculating those 60 days, we do not calculate number of days wherein the house itself was adjourned or was not in the session for more than 4 days. What is adjourned or prorogued? We are going to discuss that in the later part of the topic. And next is subject to any disqualifications. We discuss the qualifications like not holding any office of profit or becoming insolvent or being of unsound mind, etc. If any of the members is subjected to those disqualifications, then his seat becomes vacant. And next is elected for more than one post. Generally, the elections are considered for state legislature separately and for that of houses, that is your Lok Sabha, separately. Now, if a member is elected for more than one position, then he needs to choose one, that is he cannot hold both the positions simultaneously. So whichever position he gives up, that particular post or seat becomes vacant. And the next is death. The seat of a member automatically becomes vacant on his or her death. Now let us look at the presiding officer of the house. Presiding officer is just like a monitor of the class who ensures that activities take place systematically and with discipline. Similarly, a parliament or a house of a parliament consists of different members with their different views and opinions on the matters, and there are chances where the conflicts take place. Also, there should be one individual who can ensure things go in a proper procedure, and each person gets an equal opportunity to express his opinion on the subject matter on which the law is being made. And such person is referred to as the presiding officer. In case of Lok Sabha, the presiding officer is called as a speaker. Speaker is a member who is elected through votes by the Lok Sabha as soon as the Lok Sabha is formed. And in case of Rajya Sabha, the vice president of the country is the presiding officer. The speaker is elected and the vice president is the ex officio chairman of the Rajya Sabha as written down in the constitution. That is, whoever is the vice president will automatically become the presiding officer of Rajya Sabha. The term of the speaker in a Lok Sabha is 5 years, and in case of Rajya Sabha is also 5 years. A speaker is removed in case of Lok Sabha by the majority of votes passed by the members through a resolution. That is, if majority of the people vote for his removal, then the speaker stands removed from his position but continues to remain a member of the Lok Sabha. And in case of vice president, he is removed from the position of presiding officer by a process of impeachment. Impeachment is a removing process for president, vice president, or the judges of Supreme Court. And in case wherein the presiding officer, that is, if in case of Lok Sabha the speaker is not available, a deputy speaker takes the charge and he follows all the duties and acquires all the powers which a speaker holds temporarily. And in case of Rajya Sabha, then there is a deputy chairman who takes the charge of the house in the absence of vice president. Hope we are clear with what is a role of a presiding officer. Let us see the powers of the speaker of the Lok Sabha in detail. First is to conduct the business of the house. Now, business of the house means carrying out the essential activities or the purpose for which the house has been formed. That is, to decide which bill is a money bill or not. Carrying out the process for making law, which includes voting or placing the bill on the table. Deciding the date and time where the meeting has to take place. Also making the decision with respect to passing of the resolution for removal of the president or any other position such as vice president or the judge. Apart from that, he also conducts disciplinary function. As we saw that different members have their own views which they can share in the parliament, there are chances of conflict and chaos in the house. And at that time, speaker has to take the command of the house and ensure proper discipline and the procedure, that is the code of conduct, and punish those members who do not follow the rules and regulations of the house accordingly. Next is administrative function. The parliament exercises some control over the government or the executive by raising different kind of questions, and the speaker ensures that these questions are properly placed in the parliament and opportunity is given for the executive to state the facts and acknowledge the parliament accordingly. The members are asked questions by the ministers and they seek information from them, and in this form the parliament exercises control over the executive. Next is parliamentary committees. Sometimes the lawmaking business is more complex when the fact requires better research and skill, and at that time, for better research, the parliament may form a committee, and the speaker by default becomes the leader or the chairman of that committee in carrying out the due process of law, and therefore it's an important function performed by the speaker for facilitation of proper formation of law for the country. And other functions are called as miscellaneous functions, like setting up the agenda or carrying out the various activities with respect to the visitors or the parliamentary building, etc. Now let us take a look at the parliamentary procedures. Parliamentary procedures are the basic formalities which the members of the houses or the parliament have to undergo. First is sessions. Parliament or the house of a parliament, they meet at least twice in a year. Basically, there are three sessions, that is budget session, monsoon session, and winter session. And as per the law, the parliament should meet within a gap of 6 months to carry out their business. Next is quorum. Quorum means a minimum members which are required for the meeting to commence or the business of the parliament to commence, which is 1/10 of the total membership. If the presence of the members is less than that of the 1/10 of the total members, then the meeting cannot be commenced or the business cannot be commenced because of lack of quorum. Therefore, quorum is very essential. And next is question hour. As we discussed that the parliament and the ministers, they can exercise control over the government and the executives by raising questions, that is done in a question hour at each working day of the Lok Sabha. 1 hour is given for for raising questions and seeking information from the executive by the ministers. A prior notice of the question should be given and submitted to the speaker. There are three types of questions which are raised. One is start question, next is unstart, and the third is short notice. Start questions are the one of which the oral answers are required. So the minister can raise the question to the executive in the house and the executive can orally answer those questions. Unstart ones are the questions wherein the replies are required in a written form. This also requires a notice to be given to a speaker for at least 10 days prior to the meeting day or the day when the minister seeks to ask the question. And last is short notice. Short notice are the type of questions which are asked immediately depending upon the urgency of the matter. For asking such questions, prior notice may not be necessarily given 10 days before the meeting. It could be given somewhere around 5 or 4 days before depending upon the urgency of the matter. Next is 0 hour. 0 hour is an open-ended conversation or a time period wherein discussions and debates take place. No notice is required to be given to the speaker. It's an open forum where the ministers or the members can raise questions to each other of their respective departments and clear the queries they have. Next is types of motions. Motions are generally bills which are placed in the house, such as adjournment. Adjournment is a type of motion wherein the business of the house is postponed for that particular day or for a particular time period, depending upon a lot of chaos or finding some other matter as most urgent at that point of time, so postponing the other businesses. No confidence motion is one which is passed by at least 50 members in the form of a resolution. When they find that the confidence is no more existing in the Prime Minister and they want to dissolve the Lok Sabha, if maximum members vote for the motion, that is in favor of the motion, then the Lok Sabha stands dissolved. And next is prorogation. Prorogation of the House is wherein the House has completed its business for a particular session and therefore the Parliament or the House stands prorogued. Adjournment is when a business is postponed or completed for a particular day, whereas prorogation is for a particular session. Now let us take a look at the powers and the function of the Houses. One is legislative powers, which is the most important. Legislative powers includes making laws on the different subject matters mentioned in the Union List and the Concurrent List. Apart from that, also modifying or amending the existing laws which are not consistent with the environment or the current scenario. For example, say the voting age earlier was 21, but as per the changing circumstances, the need of the hour stated that the age should be reduced to 18. So the law is the same, only it is modified or amended. Next is financial powers. Financial powers are the powers with respect to the money, distribution and circulation or spending of money by the government. It could be collection of taxes, changing the rate of taxes, or spending the money into different areas or fields. Next is judicial powers. It includes removal of the judges of the Supreme Court or High Court, or it is carrying out the impeachment procedure of the President and the Vice President. So this is a power exercised for making decision on whatever is just and includes equity and good conscience. Next is electoral powers. Electoral powers is choosing or voting for a particular position, like selecting or electing a speaker, deputy speaker, or a chairman for a parliamentary committee, etc. And other powers are like administrative powers, like time to time exercising control over the executive and the government in the form of question hour or 0 hours, etc. Now we will be looking at each of the powers in detail. Now here comes financial powers. First is, it includes budget preparation. Like that happens in our home, that once we receive salary or income, we plan how to spend them. That is to save some amount, is to spend on food, clothing, etc. Similarly, the government has to decide where and when to spend their money and in what form to store their revenue or reserves. This cannot be decided by the government only. It requires approval of all the members of the parliament. And this whole process is called as budget preparation. Next is supplementary grants. Sometimes the expenditure in a particular area or in a particular activity in the country may be beyond what was allowed in the budget. So in that case, the ministry or the government can request for extra expenditure, and that is called as supplementary grants. The members vote for it, and once it requires a majority vote, the supplementary grant is given. Next is vote on account. Generally, the budget is prepared and is exercised post February. Before the budget is prepared, that time period requires expenditure in the country and government requires money for the same. So at that time, you can say a temporary statement is created by the government based on the estimated expenditure and revenue, and it is submitted with the House. The House, after discussion, votes on that particular statement, and that is called as vote on account. Next is salaries. Deciding salaries of different members or judges or the public servant, etc., is exercised by the House, and it is also a part of the financial power. And next is taxes, imposition and changes, which I've already discussed, that change of the rate of the taxes or where it has to be imposed, how it has to be imposed. It also covered under the financial powers. Next is judicial, electoral and executive powers. Judicial powers, as I told you, is impeachment of the president and other positions like vice president. And it's not a short-term procedure, it is a long procedure which requires maximum or absolute majority of the House. And that is the reason that till date no president so far has been impeached in India. Next is removal of judges. This is also a lengthy procedure and it requires a just cause and needs to be passed with both the houses. And this is also cumbersome. That is the reason no judge so far has been impeached in India. Next is punishment. The powers here involve giving punishment to the ones who do not follow the code of conduct or breach any of their public duty. Next is electoral, that is election of the president and the vice president, which takes place involving both the houses of the parliament. And in case of president, it also includes the state legislative assemblies. And next is executive powers, which is question hour zero or no confidence motions, under which the questions are raised to the executive or the government and they need to answer and provide the ministers with the information with respect to the functioning of the country. Let us look at the types of bills. Bills, when passed, becomes law. Now, how the bill turns to be a law? That is, it is placed in either of the house. Both the houses pass the bill by giving the majority votes. After that, it is submitted with the president. Once the president provides his assent, the bill becomes a law. Now, there are different types of bills having their own features or characteristics. Ordinary bills are the ones which can originate in either of the house. That is, the bill can be placed in Lok Sabha also or Rajya Sabha also. On the other hand, money bill can only originate in the Lok Sabha. That is, only Lok Sabha has the powers to place money bill on the table. Next is ordinary bills. In case of disagreement, can be referred to a joint sitting. That is, if either of the house is having a conflict or there is no majority for passing the bill or rejecting the bill either, in that case, the president can summon or call both the houses under one roof, which is called as joint sitting, which is presided by the speaker. And at that time, majority of the votes is considered and the bill is either rejected or passed. On the other hand, money bill in Rajya Sabha has virtually no power. That is, once the Lok Sabha has passed the money bill, Rajya Sabha has to accept it within 14 days. और ईदर इट कैन रिकमेंड सम चेंजेस. लोकसभा कैन एक्सेप्ट दोज चेंजेस आर नॉट, बट स्टिल द मनी बिल स्टैंड्स पास्ट एंड इट इज़ गिवन टू द प्रेसिडेंट फॉर हिज असेंट. ऑर्डिनरी बिल्स आर प्रिसाइडेड बाय स्पीकर इन द जॉइंट सिटिंग और इफ इंडिविजुअल हाउसेज देन बाय द प्रिसाइडिंग ऑफिसर्स. मनी बिल इज ऑलवेज प्रिसाइडेड बाय द स्पीकर इन लोकसभा एज इट इज़ नेवर प्लेस्ड इन द राज्यसभा और नेवर ओरिजिनेट्स इन द राज्यसभा. सो हियर वी क्लियरली कैन डिमार्केट बिटवीन द ऑर्डिनरी बिल्स एंड द मनी बिल्स एंड वी हैव नाउ इन डिटेल अंडरस्टूड हाउ द पार्लियामेंट वर्क्स. द पॉइंट्स मैंशनड इन दिस वीडियो कैन बी यूज फॉर राइटिंग द आंसर्स एज वेल. For any question or a query, you can mention them in the comment section. Also, do mention the topics for which you want us to make videos on. And thank you for your amazing response. And we hope that you share the same love to us in the future as well and motivate us to do better and better. Thank you. And do like, subscribe, and share our channels. Thank you.